All right. Systemic lupus erythematosus. Okay, we totally got this. Systemic is easy and refers to affecting multiple organs in the body. Erythematosus means reddening of the skin. All right. Lupus is Latin for wolf. So, affects multiple organs, wolf, reddening of the skin. Not exactly. The modern use of lupus usually refers to a variety of diseases that affect the skin, which was possibly originally used since these diseases resemble a wolf bite on the patient's skin. Is that true? Who knows? At any rate, systemic lupus erythematosus, or SLE, sometimes just lupus, is a disease that's systemic and affects a wide variety of organs, but notably often causes red lesions on the skin. Alright, but how does lupus affect all these organs? Well, usually the immune system protects the body's tissues from invaders, but lupus is an autoimmune disease, which means that the immune cells start attacking the tissues they're supposed to protect. With lupus, essentially any tissue or organ can be targeted. And just like a ton of other autoimmune diseases, it's not completely clear why it develops. And like most diseases, it's the result of both genetics and the environment. Alright, so let's go over a specific scenario to show how this usually plays out. Let's say that this guy has susceptibility genes, genes that make him susceptible to getting lupus. And he's exposed to UV radiation in sunlight, which we know is an environmental risk factor for lupus. Well, given enough UV rays, think like sunburn, the cell's DNA can become so badly damaged that the cell undergoes programmed cell death, or apoptosis, and it dies. This produces these tiny apoptotic bodies and exposes the insides of the cell, including parts of the nucleus, like DNA, histones, and other proteins, to the rest of the body. Well, those susceptibility genes specifically have an effect on this person's immune system, such that their immune cells are more likely to think that these are foreign, or antigens. And since they're from the nucleus, we call them nuclear antigens. And those immune cells try to attack them. Not only that though, susceptibility genes also cause this person to have less effective clearance, essentially meaning that they aren't as good at getting rid of these apoptotic bodies, and so they end up having more nuclear antigens floating around. This means that B cells might swing by, see them, and start the production of antibodies against these pieces of nucleus, which are called anti-nuclear antibodies. And these guys are present in almost all cases of lupus. Alright, so those anti-nuclear antibodies bind to the nuclear antigens, forming antigen-antibody complexes. These complexes can get into the blood and then drift away and deposit or stick to the vessel wall in all sorts of different organs and tissues, like the kidneys, the skin, the joints, and the heart. Deposited complexes then initiate a local inflammatory reaction, which causes damage through the activation of the complement system, which, after a huge cascade of enzyme activation, leaves cell membranes with channels that let fluid and molecules go in and out all willy-nilly, causing the cell to burst and die. Usually, though, you'd want this to happen to a foreign cell or an infected cell, not healthy cells. When tissues become damaged as a result of these immune complexes, it's known as a type 3 hypersensitivity reaction. UV radiation isn't the only way to damage cells, though, right? It therefore isn't the only trigger that's thought to be associated with lupus. Other potential triggers that have been associated with lupus include cigarette smoking, viruses, bacteria, use of certain medications like procainamide, hydralazine, and isoniazid, as well as sex hormones, particularly estrogen, which might be partly why lupus is more common in women, especially considering it's about 10 times more common in women than men during reproductive years, but only about 2 or 3 times more common in childhood or past the age of 65. Okay, as a quick recap, the model that's generally thought to be what leads to the symptoms of lupus starts with some environmental trigger, which damages cells and causes apoptosis and the release of nuclear antigens. At this point, the genetic components come in, and the person likely has certain genes that make them not so good at clearing these apoptotic bodies and nuclear antigens. So you end up with a lot of nuclear antigens floating around. In combination, they probably also have genes that cause their immune cells to recognize these nuclear antigens as foreign, which initiates an immune response, creates anti-nuclear antibodies that bind to the antigens and then float around and deposit in various tissues, which causes inflammation. These deposits and inflammation seem to be the cause of most of the symptoms of lupus, which remembers a type 3 hypersensitivity reaction. Many patients, though, also develop antibodies targeting other cells, like red and white blood cells, and molecules like various phospholipids, which can mark them for phagocytosis and destruction, leading to additional symptoms. And this is considered a type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, although it isn't fully understood why some of these antibodies targeting specific cells and molecules develop. So the classic presentation of lupus is fever, joint pain, and a rash in a woman of childbearing age. But the actual diagnosis is difficult because it can affect a variety of people of different genders and ages, and there are also a wide variety of symptoms. There are general symptoms like fever and weight loss, as well as specific symptoms depending on the specific organ system being affected and damaged. In fact, it's so unpredictable that a diagnosis is given only when 4 or more of 11 diagnostic criteria are met. The first few have to do with the skin and often happen to sun-exposed areas. The first is a malar rash, meaning a rash over the cheeks that spares the nasolabial folds, sometimes just called a butterfly rash, and this appears after sun exposure. Second is a discoid rash, which are chronic rashes in sun-exposed areas that are plaque-like or form a sort of patchy redness and can scar. Finally, a general photosensitivity of the skin, essentially a catch-all category for other rashes that happen to sun-exposed areas, typically only lasting a couple days. Another type of tissue that can be damaged is the mucosa, which is the inner membrane of various tissues. So the fourth criteria is ulcers in the mucous membrane of the mouth or the nose. Along with the mucosa, lupus can also affect the serosa, which is like the outer membrane of an organ or tissue. So if it gets inflamed, people get serositis, which could manifest as something like pleuritis, which is inflammation of the lining around the lungs and the chest cavity, or as pericarditis, inflammation of the lining of the heart. Although this isn't strictly a criteria, it's worth noting that lupus can affect any layer of the heart, meaning in addition to inflammation of the pericardium, they might also have inflammation of the endocardium and myocardium, leading to endocarditis and myocarditis, of which the former presents as Lippmann Sachs endocarditis, where vegetations form, which are essentially these clumps of fibrin, a blood clotting protein, and immune cells, around the mitral valve. Next, if the joints get inflamed, patients might also develop arthritis, specifically needing 2 or more joints to meet the criteria. If the kidneys are affected, patients might develop renal disorders, like abnormal amounts of urine protein, or diffuse proliferative glomerulonephritis, inflammation of the glomeruli. For reasons that aren't completely understood, some autoantibodies that target receptors in the brain have been implicated as well. And this can cause neurological disorders, like seizures and psychosis. Sort of along the same lines, patients can have autoantibodies against components of the blood, causing various hematologic disorders. For example, they'll get anemia if blood cells are targeted, thrombocytopenia if platelets are targeted, and leukopenia if white blood cells or immune cells are targeted. And that last one's kind of a mind-bender because it means that your immune system is attacking your immune system. Alright, so the last two criteria have to do with specific antibodies being found in the blood, the first one being anti-nuclear antibody, which we already went through. Now, a large proportion of patients with lupus have these, meaning this test is very sensitive. But this test isn't very specific, since these are also seen in other autoimmune diseases. Finally, they can have some other self-directed antibody that isn't anti-nuclear antibody, which can be one of three types. It could be anti-Smith, which is an antibody against small ribonucleoproteins, or it could be anti-dsDNA, which is against double-stranded DNA, and is often seen more during periods of active disease. And these two are relatively specific for lupus. A third type of antibody, though, is antiphospholipid antibody, which is actually usually against proteins that are bound to the phospholipids, and is less specific for lupus, meaning that it can pop up in other situations. There are three types of antiphospholipid antibodies. Anticardiolipin, which can cause a false positive test for syphilis, since anticardiolipin antibodies are also sometimes involved in syphilis. The other two are lupus anticoagulant, also known as lupus antibody, and anti-beta-2 glycoprotein 1. Sometimes, because of these, patients will develop antiphospholipid syndrome, where the antiphospholipid antibodies cause a hypercoagulable state, meaning they're more prone to developing clots and having complications like deep vein thrombosis, hepatic vein thrombosis, and stroke. These patients often end up needing lifelong anticoagulation therapy. So lupus is characterized by periods of flare-ups and periods of remittance. So treatment is often aimed at preventing flares or limiting how severe they are when they do happen. To help prevent flares, some patients might have to avoid sunlight exposure with hats or long-sleeve clothes. To reduce severity of flares, corticosteroids might be used to help limit the immune response. And finally, if symptoms are really severe, certain immunosuppressive drugs might be used. Thanks for watching. You can help support us by donating on Patreon or subscribing to our channel or telling your friends about us on social media.